Today we're going to be playing...
Yes, T1 Glistener Elf with an unboxing.
Yes.
With my good friend...
Colin.
If you ever get a YouTube channel or a Twitch channel or anything like that, it's in the description.
Stop it!
Check it out and we'll put a link down there. Alright, this is the Call of the Spirits Commander 2015 deck. Featuring Daxos the Returned. Oh yeah. Time to get started. Oh yeah. Alright, do your thing. Let's see what we got. And I'll put a deck list in the description. I'll just copy and paste it from one of the myriad other websites. Yes, so much easier doing it this way. Mine is usually with keys. That's just me. I don't have nails right now, but if I do have nails, I can try it that way. But it's easier to keep up with not having nails. Alright. And so we've just gotten started. I think that sums up cardboard in general in this game. It's gone. Solid gone. Alright. Now if you don't mind, I'm going to come around. We're going to see this from your point of view. So you don't have to flip everything around. Alright, so we have our carrying case. Right now we see gold wrapped on top. The card, the token, gold. Alright. So obviously there's something in here that uses gold.
Yes.
I'm trying to remember what Theros Block card. It was the guy that's based off King Midas, but I can't remember the actual card's name.
King Makar.
What is it?
King
Makar. There we go. That's right.
What?
And I'm doing all of this while holding a baby, so forgive me if it's shaking a bit.
Alright, so you wanna just...
Yeah, just however you wanna do it, man.
Alright.
There's gold. Our experience counter, of course.
For new.
Yeah, absolutely. Spirits to be used with Daxos.
A lot of spirits.
Quite a few of them. Oh yeah, an angel.
Angels.
Okay, very nice. Knight with an angel on the back.
More angels.
Oh, there's two.
A cat with a spirit on the back. Very nice, an enchantment spirit. Okay, so that one actually works with Daxos because he makes enchantment spirits.
Yeah.
I do like that we're seeing cats,
Zombies.
Though. Zambonis. Alright, so now getting started with the actual cards themselves. Oh my goodness.
Starting with Oriscos Explorer?
Yeah, I'm liking it.
This is an actual candle.
Starting off with an uncommon, that's always fun. Enters the battlefield, X planes, X is the number of players who control more lands than you. That's a very wide effect. We're seeing this now in Knight of the White Orchid. We've seen this kind of effect in white for a while. If your opponent has more lands, that's the only way you're going to ramp, basically. All right?
Yeah.
Coinsmith gets a reprint? Yeah.
It's almost in every Constellation deck.
Yeah.
Coinsmith says necessary.
Burnish Heart, just a good value. Could go in any color deck.
Fetch lands, good in Commander.
Yeah, absolutely. Dawnglare Invoker. Now, I've never been a big fan of Invokers because they cost cheap to get out, they're under curve, and then their ability takes freakishly large amounts of mana. But,
yeah.
You know, in Commander, tap all creatures target player controls, you can get to high amounts of mana pretty much every game,
yeah.
In multiplayer at least. That being said, well, there we go. Ghostblade. Alright. Now, what's Ghostblade's deal?
It's a bestow, and it's a double strike. Enchanted creature gets +1/+1, and has double strike. So,
yeah.
Just and it triggers enchantment
so
as well with that.
So it's a 3-mana 1/1 double strike, which is way under curve. But you can bestow it for 6 mana to give a creature double strike and +1/+1. So that in and of itself, I guess, is fair. You can throw that on pretty much whatever your commander is. Your commander has double strike. That's something. There's something to be said for that.
Yeah. And it triggers Constellation. Core Sanctifiers.
Has one of my favorite arts that feature Core, to be honest. This may actually be my favorite art to feature Core, other than Stoneforge Mystic. I mean, just take a look at that. Good grief. And that midriff. And look at that beard. He has a quad-braided beard. I'm sorry, I had to.
Anyway.
That's me.
So kicker, 4 mana, basically it's 4 mana, destroy an artifact or enchantment along with the 2/3. you know, the flavor text is very appropriate. Alright, and go on from there. Monk Idealist, return an enchantment card from your graveyard to your hand.
That's pretty much the whole deck.
Pretty much, yep.
Yeah, probably.
Corpse Augur.
Corpse Augur dies, you draw X cards and lose X life, where X is the number of creature cards in target player's graveyard.
Now, importantly, it's not a May ability. You have to do that. You have to draw X, and more importantly, you have to lose X life.
Yeah.
So, it can be a downside, but usually, you don't
care. You're
going
to need it out turn 4,
that's right.
So it doesn't matter anyway.
You have 40 life and a 99 card singleton deck. Usually, you're perfectly alright with that.
Yeah.
Alright. Dreadbringer Lampets. Alright, so you... Target creature gains Intimidate.
Constellation. Whenever Dreadbringer Lampets or another enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, target creature gains Intimidate until end of turn.
Now, one thing that always got me about Intimidated Commander is because of how many multicolor commanders there are. You know, Intimidate is just based on the colors your commander is, so in this case, white, black, and artifacts can still block. That's a fair bit in Commander.
Not to mention that in combination with Daxos, you have Daxos, you play this card, and the trigger from this, you can make a token, and then the trigger from this, the token can come out and automatically have Intimidate.
Yeah, that's fair.
But you have to have a way to give it haste, I guess.
Yeah, and in white-black, there probably aren't too many ways to do that.
No. All right.
Herald of the Host, Flying Vigilance, Myriad. Ooh, Flying Vigilance and Myriad. That's a wonderful combination. Myriad, so this new keyword that's being brought in through the set, whenever a creature attacks for each opponent other than defending player, you may put a token, that's a copy of the creature on the battlefield, tapped and attacking that player or planeswalker they control. Exile at end of combat. That's a wonderful ability to put on a Flying Vigilance. This is Sarah Angel, but strictly better. Strictly better.
Alright.
Unless we get some Myriad hate going on. Alright, you tell me a little bit about Banshee of the Dread Choir.
Alright, another Myriad card, and we're talking about those. And then it's got, whenever Banshee of the Dread Choir deals combat damage to a player, that player discards a card. So this is going to be really good. It's alright for the price. 4-4 body.
Yeah.
Doesn't have flying like you think it would with a spirit, but...
Yeah, that's a good point. You would think.
But, I mean, I guess I could understand. That's a reasonable card.
That's fair enough. And I do like how Myriad is making a lot of cards that are... So a lot of these cards are not necessarily good in multiplayer Commander unless they have Myriad, because a lot of those abilities are, like, you know, you play Doomblade, you're one-ing yourself, but you're only hitting one of your opponents. But with Myriad, anytime you use a Myriad ability,
it hits everybody.
It hits everyone, yeah, absolutely. Share the love. Thief of Blood. Flying, and when it enters the battlefield, remove all counters from all permanents. Thief of Blood enters with a +1/+1 counter for each counter removed this way.
Wow.
So they have planeswalkers out. No, they don't. No, they don't. Now, also, another way to abuse this is with the card Dark Depths. Comes in with 10 snow, what, like ice counters?
Oh, yeah.
Remove all the ice counters, and you put a 2020 flying indestructible legendary black merit lage token.
Not to mention all those counters would go onto this guy. So
that's
you'd have
right.
This guy buffed up, and you'd have that 2020.
Also, no,
which is amazing. Something about O.J. Simpson. Sandstone Oracle. Alright, what do you think about this one?
When it enters the battlefield, choose an opponent. If that player has more cards in hand than you, draw cards equal to the difference. So this is only going to be good in multiplayer.
That's right.
A little expensive for 4-4 flying, but I mean, I guess if you're running out of options later game.
Importantly, it doesn't target, which matters for Leyland of Sanctity, Aegis of the Gods, etc. And I like what you said. It matters more in EDH, in multiplayer EDH, I mean to say. I like that it's a... So, whenever I see a colorless card like this, I think that it could go, potentially, into pretty much any commander deck. I mean, this is dump your hand and then refill your hand on a 7-mana 4-4 body. It's not quite Soul Ring, it's not quite Sensei's Divining Top, it's not up to that level of every deck wants it, but That's undeniably good, right?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Oh, and speaking of Soul Ring, ta-da! Commander staple. I cannot think of a single commander deck that does not want Soul Ring in it somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
This is just flat-out good card.
Speaks for itself?
Yep.
On that note, Wayfarer's Bauble as well. Another, again, can go into any color combination. Yeah.
So she'll library for a basic land card and put that card on the battlefield tapped.
Yeah. All doesn't right. go and get any land like Expedition map, but it does put it on the battlefield.
Yes, this is true.
And another, yet another card that goes in every commander deck.
So I guess these are just your staples right here.
Yeah, get print all those staples.
Lightning Greaves.
Yeah.
Zero to equip. Haste and Shroud.
Basically, you have your commander out, protect your commander on your turn.
Good for obvious reasons.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Alright. Orzhov Signet. Just another little bit of ramp.
Yeah.
I mean, there's better options, but overall, it's just you're getting an extra land drop, essentially, I guess.
I guess. That's fair to say. Like Darksteel Ingot, this is another one of those, you know, if it's in your color combination, you run the ramp, generally. I'm a little bit, just a teeny tiny bit skeptical, because Daxos only costs 3, and Daxos doesn't trigger off artifacts, but even so, that's perfectly respectable. It's 2 mana, like Darksteel Ingot, by the time you cast it, it doesn't matter, you could have cast your commander anyway.
And if you're short on good colored mana, you could turn 2 into this, and sure. Next turn you can cast Daxos.
Thought Vessel, okay. So this is, you have no maximum hand size, and add 1. Okay, so it's Reliquary Tower as an artifact, right?
Yes, and it adds mana.
Sure, that's good by me. Yeah,
and it's surprisingly a common.
Speaks for itself, yeah.
Alright.
Now, okay, so this one I actually don't reckon. Oh, wow, reading that ability with your commander.
Oh my gosh.
I'm just gonna shove your commander right next, because that's a reference for every card you see. Alright. Return
that is awesome.
All enchantment cards from your graveyard to your hand. Now, it could be, what's the card called? Replenish, I think is the name. It's the same thing, but as a sorcery. Return all enchantments that aren't auras. Or return all enchantments. Oh dear, I can't believe I can't remember this card. It has a picture of the Parthenon, and a bunch of spirits are leaving it, and it's return all enchantments to the battlefield except auras unless if they don't have target. I don't know, it's something like that. It's on the screen now. If I remember to put it up, it's on the screen. Anyway, so this is an artifact version of that. This is much easier. Well, I say much easier to cast. It's 6 mana, but not all at once.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you can divide that up in turns.
Yeah, she has control of the camera right now, so I apologize for that. Orzhov Clustone. You know, the reason you can't even give away Dragon's Maze packs.
Yeah. Same thing is your Signet, just...
Yeah, it's 3 mana.
One more to get down.
Yeah.
But you don't have to pay to tap it, so that's a plus.
And in the late game, when you don't need it anymore, just cycle it. Yeah. Easy enough. Fair enough. All right. Now, this one I'm actually pretty excited for. I think this works pretty well in the deck because so many of your creatures are enchantment creatures. Phyrexian Reclamation. You know? Simple. 2 mana, 2 life, return a creature from your graveyard to your hand. So return an enchantment creature and then replay it with Daxos.
And when you got your board, not to mention, this itself is going to trigger Constellation.
That's right.
And when you got your board all set up late game, you just start paying 2 life and triggering all those Constellation triggers, and if you have a sack outlet, sack all those things and do it again.
Man, Daxos looks so sick in a deck like this.
Yeah.
Man. All right. So what do you think about Seal of Cleansing getting a reprint?
I actually haven't seen this card.
Basically, it's an enchant. It's disenchant as an enchantment.
Okay.
But it's exactly disenchant otherwise.
Yeah. Cleansing. Destroy target. Okay.
In this deck, I think it's not strictly better because it is, after all, sorcery speed to cast, but it works for the Daxos, yeah.
Yeah, you're going to get the trigger.
Easy enough. It's another one of those cards that it hits only one opponent, and like it's a 1-for-1, which doesn't seem good in multiplayer, but at least Daxos gives it some extra value.
Yes.
Look how
fast he sinks
up. Grave Peril. Okay. Non-black creature enters the battlefield, sacrifice it. If you do, destroy that creature. Little risky, right? Because you're not mono black.
This is true.
Yeah. That's That's interesting. Yeah, it's another. It's in the cycle of standstill, right? Win X, sacrifice. If you do, Y.
Yeah.
You know, it's a. It's another one of those. Hopefully, hurt your opponent. Hopefully, make it a little bit asymmetrical. And you, but you have a fair number of white creatures we've gone over. But I think we've beaten that dead horse. What do you say? What's the next card? Little
dick. Banishing Light.
Banishing Light. What are we do to have that be Oblivion Rain?
This might as well be a staple in this deck.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair.
I don't know. Yeah, O-Ring, Banishing Light. You can. It allows you to run a Living Ring and Banishing Light. So.
Sure, sure. I mean, with Oblivion Ring, you could get into a scenario where, like, you cast the Oblivion Ring, and then after the exile trigger is resolved, but or not. Not.
Yeah, I went to hit it and goes.
Oh my goodness. I'm trying to think of how to say it. You know how. So it's two separate triggers for Oblivion Ring.
Yes.
When it enters exile, when it leaves return.
Yes.
So with the when it enters trigger on the stack. You destroy it with, say, the Seal of Cleansing, and then they don't get their creature back, or whatever permanent.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's why it's better than Banishing Light, but they've moved away from Shroud to Hexproof, they've moved away from O-Ring effects to Banishing Light effects. Which is fine, I guess. That's fine. Alright, what's next? Cage of Hands.
Enchanted creature can't attack or block, and you can pay 2 and return this card to its owner's hand.
Wow,
so
that's
you can keep enchanting something. That is nice.
Like, so the obvious advantage is if you need to hit something bigger later, you can just switch it over to that for an investment of 5 mana. But also Daxos. So you Cage of Hands their creature, and now they can't attack with it, and then at the end of their turn, return it, and then Cage of Hands their creature, and so on and so forth, getting an experience counter every single
time.
Yeah.
And if you have Constellation now, it's going to trigger all your Constellation.
That's right. Dude. Okay. So I'm expecting Flickering Ward to be in here somewhere as a result of that, because that's the case. But we'll see. Alright, so Vow of Duty.
Enchanted creature gets +2/+2 Vigilance, and can't attack you or a Planeswalker you control. So even if they find a way to, so you put this on a creature you don't want them hurting you with.
That's
and
right.
Even if they take it and they cannot swing at you.
Throw it on their commander, now their commander can't hit you. I usually see this in Corona decks, where people are playing Corona False God, and they play Vows on Corona to keep Corona from attacking you, because Corona, after all, gets, as she has control of the camera right now, the baby has control of the camera. Corona goes to everyone. You know, she's into that whole free love stuff. She, yeah,
your opinion
is. But yeah, Vow of Duty seems good in that. You know, make it, put it on your creature to make it bigger, or
exactly.
Yeah, or put it on their creature to save yourself. It's also a good diplomacy card. This is great. This is great. Hey, if you won't attack me anyway, I'll enchant their creature instead of yours. You know, that sort of thing. If you'll be my ally, I'll enchant their creature. Yeah, she sneezed. She's playing with my hair now. This is painful. All right, let's go on. Fallen Ideal.
All right, enchanted creature has flying and sacrifices creature. This creature gets +2/+1 until end of turn. All right, I could see that if you have okay, but when the ideal is put into a graveyard from the battlefield, return to its owner's hand. I could see that with something that allows you to return things.
I'm in so much pain right now. Let go of my hair, darling. Your foot has my hair. Yeah, and the fact that it's return, you know, it's one of those return it from your graveyard to your hand to recast with Daxos. You know, good value like that. Yeah, you're right. And it's not sacrifice this creature, obviously. It's sacrifice a creature. So it's a Nantuko Husk style effect again, I guess. Alright.
Seal of Doom.
Alright.
Sacrifice Seal of Doom, destroy target non-black creature, it can't be regenerated. I mean, this is good and bad. It can't hit your big black threats like Grave Titan or anything like that, but whatever it does hit, it can't be regenerated, and you're going to get your enchantment trigger.
That's right. That's it's another, that whole seal cycle was you know, take a card that's already been printed and turn it to an enchantment. And that's basically what that whole cycle did. So this is just another one. You know, we had disenchant last time. I can't remember the name of this one. The two in black, destroy target non-black, can't be regenerated. It's Doomblade, but bigger and can't be regenerated. Whatever it is. All right.
Murder, no.
No, not murder. Vow of Malice. +2/+2, it has Intimidate, and can't attack you or a planeswalker you control.
So, same thing as the... whatever it was.
Poor thing, I got you. I got you.
Same thing as Vow of Duty, that's what it was. But, black, and it gives that creature Intimidate.
I think she wants to be picked up. I'm sorry, YouTube. This camera was fine until she finished her drink. Yeah, she's actually 21. That kind of drink. No. All right. But yeah, that's pretty much it. Same argument we were making earlier. Intimidate may be better than Vigilance, but I'm tempted to say that it's generally not. I'm tempted to say that you'd prefer to have Vigilance, because oftentimes Intimidate will not let you get through, especially in a multiplayer game. Someone's running black or white. All right, what do you say, man?
Yeah, I think
next order of business.
Aura of Silence.
Okay.
Artifacts and enchantment spells your opponents cast cost 2 more to cast. Sacrifice Aura of Silence, destroy a target artifact or enchantment. So this is going to shut down another Daxos deck or another Constellation deck you see.
That's right.
Which is not good for me if I see it played against me.
Fair enough.
But well,
you've got one yourself, so there's that at least.
Yeah, this is true. But it also allows... I mean, when you're done with the card in late game where it doesn't even matter anymore, you can just sacrifice and destroy target artifact and enchantment. So it pays for itself.
Yeah. She has her hand over my eye, and I have it closed just in case she scratches. That would be bad. All right, go for it. Aha! Hey, we finally get to you.
Like, I've seen this card somewhere.
Stupid.
Huh. There's a similarity here. What do you think? I don't know. let me do a detective check. I failed. Okay. Alright. Anyway.
Moving on from that.
It really, I think it has a pretty good art. There's a good contrast between the left and right side over here. The warm and the cool, I guess. She has the screen again. All right. Yeah. No, that's good. It's good. Now, if any card... I agree with Mythic MTG Tech and Brian Rowe. If any card from any of these commander decks can actually see some Legacy play, it's Karlov of the Ghost Council. The mana cost is a little bit intensive, but if a Soul Sisters or a Soul Sisters type deck shows up in Legacy, this is the guy to do it. Whenever you gain life, put 2+1/+1 counters on Karlov, and then you remove 6 to exile target creature. And on top of that, that is some of the best flavor text I've seen in quite a while from Wizards. Does Tessa think me blind to her scheming? Ambition runs in our family. So suddenly the Orzhov Church is the Mafia, I guess.
Yeah, I guess so.
Or Game of Thrones. I don't know. Could be
overall
that.
Solid card though. Even this deck.
Very good. Very, very good. It can go huge. Now, unfortunately, it's a spirit advisor. I want to play it in something like Death and Taxes, but Cavern of Souls is probably not naming Spirit. Spirit of the Labyrinth is the only other card that fits in that deck that it could actually name. Oh, anyway, enough about Legacy. Let's get on with it.
Alright.
Speaking of Tessa, we have Big Tessa, not Tiny Leaders Tessa. Honey. Honey.
Alright, Vigilance and Protection from Creatures.
Jeez.
Whenever a creature deals combat damage to you, destroy that creature. Put a 1/1 white and black spirit creature token with flying onto the battlefield. Now, that doesn't...
Don't get the camera, honey bunny. Oh, yeah, so on the one hand... Oh, what were you about to say?
Well, overall, it's mainly gonna make you no longer a target. No one's gonna want to swing at you and kill all the creatures.
That's right. Yeah, so destroy that creature. That means that unless they're swinging for lethal, they're going to lose
their whole field.
Yeah, that's insane. So basically it forces, usually anyway, it forces the opponents to either deal with Tessa first or build up until they have actual factual lethal, which is great. It gives you all the time in the world.
And you get one once.
Yeah. Yeah, if they actually do fall for it for some reason, you get one once.
Alright.
With fly. Commander creatures you control.
Get +2/+2 and have indestructible.
Now presumably that means just Daxos, unless you mind control somebody and take their commander. I'd assume. Would you do me a favor? Could you take him for just a quick sec?
Oh, really?
She kinda has my hair.
She's riding.
Yeah.
That's not so good.
Okay. Now, where were we?
Grasp of Fate. Enchantment, so gonna trigger. When it enters the battlefield, for each opponent, exile up to one target non-land permanent that player controls.
Wow.
Wow.
That so it's Banishing awesome. Light for every single opponent.
Banishing Light on steroids.
Yeah.
That is awesome.
Dude, yeah, I take that. I take that so hard. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's freaking amazing.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So, Shielded by Faith. This kind of reminds me a little bit of the Lightning Greaves or Swiftfoot Boots package, except it's an enchantment, so it works off Daxos. Protect your commander, and then, you know, when a creature enters, attach it to it. You may attach it to it. So
you don't have to move it around.
That's right. But the important part about that is that, like Lightning Greaves is a zero mana equip, this kind of feels like a zero mana because all you have to do is play your commander and then switch it right over.
Exactly.
Oh, there you go. Daxos is Torment. All right.
It's like his like father or something.
Jeez. I am your father.
Oh, it's running away. You don't see that. Constellation.
So what's the constellation on this one?
Whenever Daxos' Torment or another enchantment enters battlefield under your control, Daxos' Torment becomes a 5/5 demon with flying and haste in addition to its other types until it's
okay. So what's important about that, I find, is that it's a creature on your turn, it's not a creature on their turn, generally, unless we have some flash enchantments going on here.
Yeah.
And that means that their sorcery speed removal, like Wrath's, might not actually work on Daxos' Torment. So you can make it a creature on your turn, and then it's protecting itself on their turn. So that's always fun, I guess.
And on top of everything, it's an enchantment, so...
Yeah, it's a 4-mana, 5/5 flyer and haste. That's above curve by quite a bit. Yeah, this is one of my favorite cards in the set. Yeah, I'd say anyway.
All right.
Righteous Confluence. Okay, so this is part of the Confluence, I think is the name of the cycle, where you choose three, but you can choose them more than once. In this case, our three are a 2/2 white knight creature token. I think that's Reed Duke, right? Reed Duke's, or was Reed Duke's a green-white token? It was a knight.
Green-white.
It was green-white? Oh, yes. Okay. And then Exile Enchantment.
Or you gain 5 life.
That's fair. I mean, for 5 mana, none of those seem terribly exciting to me, like with the blue one. But this is fine, I guess.
I mean, if you do one of each.
It's a mirror breaker. This is another one of those, if you're playing against another Daxos deck, dear God.
Yes, exactly.
What's Deadly Tempest? Well, it's destroy all creatures. We finally get around to a Wrath effect. Each player loses life equal to the number of creatures he or she controlled that were destroyed this way.
So I guess you do this when you're on the downside of things.
Sure, yeah. That's, if you absolutely have to.
Or maybe sack all yours to a sack outlet.
Sure.
And then get the benefits of that and destroy everyone else's.
No, that's exactly right, my friend. Absolutely.
Alright,
what's next? Mesa Enchantress. I'm used to saying Mesa.
Whenever you cast an enchantment spell, you may draw a card. Holy cow.
Yeah, that so you're awesome, going to turn into an Enchantress deck very quickly when you get her out.
That is phenomenal.
Absolutely, 100%.
There's another Eidolon of Blossoms does this as well, so yep. I guess this is the white Eidolon of Blossoms.
There's also Argothian Enchantress and Enchantress's Presence, but they're green, unfortunately, just like Eidolon of Blossoms. But I think this is the only white one that has that effect.
Just trying to find a substitute for those.
There you go. Night Howler. Okay. Oh, Spirit Dancer. That's just off auras, though. Yeah. So, you know, you've seen this before. It's a reprint. Not much to say here. +X/+X. All creatures in all graveyards. Number of creatures in all graveyards,
though. Not just yours, not just theirs.
Now, unfortunately, you aren't doing very much to, you know, just dominate their graveyards, so it's just good value. The more players, the bigger it gets. Maybe not so good in one-on-one EDH, but, you know, that's fine.
Maybe combine with a board wipe.
Yeah, that's fair.
Alright.
It's also a rare. That's kind of lame to use on the rare slot, but that's fine. Speaking of rare, Fate Unraveler. Whenever an opponent draws a card, one damage. Okay, so share the pain. You know, this deals it to everyone a little bit equally. Unfortunately, what I don't like about this card is that it makes you a target for everyone, potentially.
Yeah, it would. It would, but... combine this. What do we have black that's going to make everybody draw?
And if I get a direct impact to the bow,
I don't know that we've come across anything like that in this, but that'd be a good way to look to add new cards to the set.
Yeah,
absolutely. You know, I think off the top of my head, because I'm an Infect player, I think Caress of Phyrexia, but you're not playing that outside of an Infect
deck. Yeah, no.
And white-black Infect does not seem like a good color combo for that.
But it's also an enchantment, so...
Sure.
Card.
Yeah. A Janny's Chosen, oh my god. Whenever an enchantment enters the battlefield under your control, a 2/2 white cat creature token, that, if it was an aura you cast, gets to attach it straight to it. What? What?
Oh my gosh.
Value? Value town?
Holy cow. So you can just throw down an enchantment and it automatically has a 2/2 cat it's attached to.
Yeah,
that's something like the one that you can keep rebouncing to your hand and casting.
Ding, ding, ding. I used to run this in a modern deck. In a modern, I called it Mono White Enchantress. Or it plays kind of like the Hexproof decks, but your creatures don't have Hexproof. So you need to be careful. They're a lot more fragile, but they're also a lot more threatening if they can not be dealt with. So anyway, enough of this guy. Let's get on past a Janny's Chosen. Of course, it wouldn't be in a Constellation deck without Doomwake Giant to kill all their tokens.
Obvious reasons.
Yeah, let's move on. That kind of speaks for itself.
Yep.
Celestial Ancient. Another get value whenever you cast a creature, or an enchantment, rather. Now, it's a +1/+1 counter not until end of turn.
Would you just turn
each creature you control?
Yeah. It looks like it's way under curve. 5 mana for a 3/3 flyer. Until you realize that in this deck, that thing is getting ridiculously huge.
And it's not just that creature. It's going to put it on all your creatures. So every time you cast an enchantment spell, which is almost every card in the deck, you're going to be dropping 1/1 counters on everything, which is super solid.
Looking at that art while I'm at it, it kind of reminds me of the enchantment of the gods from Theros. They have the stars going through it. Like, but it's not an enchantment creature. It's just an elemental.
With an enchantment idea to it.
Yeah, that's fair. Okay. Celestial Archon. Okay. +4/+4, flying and first strike. This, to me, was one of the most hyped cards when it was spoiled in its original set. This to me, got me really excited. But... it didn't turn out to be quite as awesome as everyone hoped it would be. You know, what can you say?
I mean, it fills a slot in this deck, so
fair. +4/+4, flying first strike. Can't argue with that.
Can't. And if you have that thing that makes cats, it'll automatically attach to that.
There you go. Treasury Thrall. Attacks, return artifact, creature, or enchantment from your graveyard to your hand. So, another return enchantment to your hand. Extort, just for a little bit of value. Now, extort, I really love in multiplayer. Pay one mana, they all lose one, you gain one times the number of players. Minus you. So, yeah.
Just look at the art.
Oh, yeah, that big dump. What is that thing?
I don't know.
It's like a Bantha from Star Wars, but cooler. Super ripped and waxed. Kind of waxed.
Veins showing and all.
Yeah.
All right. Moving on.
Yeah. Silent Sentinel. Attacks? Good grief. Now, return target enchantment from your graveyard to the battlefield.
That's not like the other one that's set to your hand. This one's straight to the battlefield.
True, but this is also 7 mana.
Higher mana curve, but you gotta have something to do late game.
This is EDH. We will get to 7, generally.
Yes.
Alright.
Super solid.
Connections. Seems perfect. It's an enchantment. This is good. You know, you've run out of things to do. Here's some velocity.
Pay a life and tap a mana and draw a card. I mean,
yeah, one life with 40 life to start, and not such a big deal.
Yep.
Karmic Justice.
Whenever a spell or ability an opponent controls destroys a non-creature permanent you control, you may destroy a target permanent that opponent controls. So, it's pretty much just going to get you ahead of the game, I guess.
Hey, you want to waste my land? I'll waste your land. Or, well, I guess this is non-creature, yeah. So, you know, destroy my enchantment, I'll destroy yours. Yeah, so on and so forth. This is basically just, you know, karma. It's karma.
Yeah. It's self-explanatory.
Good art, too. I like it.
Alright.
Oh.
Phyrexian Arena.
Jeez, that card.
That, it gets there. Seen in, what's the modern deck you usually see it in?
Well, I'm sure it's just a lot of fringe play in a lot of decks, but in EDH especially, because the life total doesn't matter so much. It's a singleton deck, so you get more value from a given card draw. And it's an enchantment here, so Daxos loves it.
Combine that with Underworld Connections, you're going crazy.
Yeah, you totally are, absolutely.
Alright.
And the aforementioned one that lose X life, draw X cards. Yeah, X is the number of creatures in target graveyard. Yeah. Marshall's Anthem, okay. So a good, worst case scenario, it's a 4-mana Glorious Anthem. Best case scenario, you also get to return some creatures to the battlefield. Some, plural, potentially. Yeah, that's always fun.
Alright.
Easy enough.
Can't we get some new voices?
Dictate of Heliolite. Okay, so if those spirits weren't big enough already, those enchantment spirits that have 10 experience counters because you're playing Daxos, let's just make them even bigger.
Not to mention, you also have, what was the 5/5, the Daxos Torment?
Yeah, there we go.
You can, this is one of those things where you can make him a 5/5 on their turn, so if you need
that's
a blocker.
True. Yeah, you there you blocker. Go. Fair enough.
Flash.
Oh, dig it. Sigil. Oh my god, this deck. Sigil of the Empty Throne. Play an enchant, or cast an enchantment, 4/4 Angel.
Simple enough. That's just broken.
Yeah, jeez. Where's Luminardi Ascension? It's Luminarch Ascension, but I call it Luminardi because they're doing this thing in the art where there's two angels and this priest and they make a triangle amongst themselves, and I'm like, I should stick the Eye of Providence there, like Illuminati Ascension.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah. Alright, anyway, enough of that.
Black Market. I don't think I've ever seen this card before, actually.
That's fun.
Whenever a creature dies, put a charge counter on Black Market. At the beginning of your pre-combat rain phase, add one black mana to your mana pool for each charge counter on Black Market. So it's basically a quick way to ramp.
Very, very quick way to ramp. I guess the Golgari deck benefits more from this, but you get it enough. It's when a creature dies, so even your tokens count. It's not and goes to the, you know, it's not...
Combine that with a board
number
wipe.
Number in the graveyard. Yeah, there you go.
And you got the trigger on Daxos.
Not just you, but your opponents as well. Yeah, that card is pretty sick. You will have all of the mana. So, Diabolic Revelation for the win. Diabolic Revelation, X equals 20.
Oh yeah, that's awesome.
Alright, what do you say? Necromancer's Covenant. Dude, that art. Whoa, that art.
Oh, that is sweet. Alright, when Necromancer's Covenant enters the battlefield, exile all creatures' cards from target player's graveyard. Then put a 2/2 black zombie creature token onto the battlefield for each card exiled this way. Zombies you control have a lifelink.
Yes.
That is awesome.
It may not be that consequential in EDH. Lifelink is one of those... It's not a keyword that matters all that much, I find. If for no other reason than when one person wins, they tend to overwhelmingly win.
But now you combine that with by dropping a Grave Titan in this deck.
Yeah.
You're going crazy.
No, that's fair. That's absolutely fair.
Alright.
Ancient Craving. Draw 3 cards, lose 3 life. I might want to mention that with Necromancer's Covenant, it has a bit of a nombo with some of the cards we've seen that care about number in their grave. Like Night Howler and the aforementioned lose X life, draw X cards. But that's fine. Ancient Craving. Draw 3, lose 3 life. Simple enough. It's a 3/1. 3 life doesn't matter so much in this format. It's just card advantage for 4 mana. Fair enough, right?
Yep.
Fair. Logan, will you sit down?
Okay, I got excited. We'll get to that card next. But first, Guild. This is where we're using our gold tokens.
Sit down, man.
Exalted. Simple enough. It's removal, you get a colorless artifact token named gold, and sack it and make mana. So you kill and get mana.
That's right. It's a removal spell that costs a little more because it's giving you mana afterwards. That's fine. And a blocker, potentially. Okay. Easy enough, yeah. That's what got me excited. Open the vaults. Return all artifact enchantment cards from your graveyard to the battlefield under their owner's control. Holy shit.
That now, is amazing.
Granted, it's not just you, it's your opponents as well. But you should be benefiting
a lot more than they will. A lot more.
Other than maybe like a Mimnarch deck or some other like blue artifact carrying deck, that's...
You're going to be the only one that's going to be really going crazy off of this.
Yeah, dude, that's awesome. When the vaults are empty, everyone is rich. The dulcet tones of baby in the background. Alright. And then, the next white and black, Death Grasp.
Okay. X damage target creature, you gain X life.
Creature or player.
Or creature or player.
So it's a consumed spirit throwing white in, I think. I think that's basically it.
I guess so.
Alright, so there we go.
Moving on.
Dawn to Dusk. Choose one or both. Target enchantment from your graveyard to your hand. Destroy target enchantment.
Fair enough.
Yeah, sure. Another Mirror Breaker, potentially.
Yeah, there you go.
Destroy their Aura Shards.
Oh my god.
Okay, so lots of basic lands. Do you mind looking through to see if there are any non-basic lands in there? All of those arts. I mean, I can really dig the Sunscape one. That one right there? Yeah.
What?
Oh, the one you just set down? Gorgeous. Alright, anyway.
I'm only seeing basics right now.
They'll be later on.
Oh, there we go.
Alright.
I'm lost.
So I see a Vivid Marsh, which means there's a Vivid Meadow right behind it, I'm sure. Vivid Marsh? Yep, charge counter? Yep, there it is, Vivid Meadow. Easy enough. You know, you get the two charge counters, they can make any color until you run out of counters, then it's just the one it's set for. Easy enough. Baron Moor for cycling, which means there's the white one as well. I'm assuming that for all of these, there's symmetry. Well, maybe, maybe not.
Maybe not.
Right. Command Tower, another goes in every commander
deck. Essential
commander.
Yeah. Yes.
Maybe not if you're monocolor. Even then, I sometimes wonder, no, not monocolor, but other than that, yeah. Evolving Wilds, okay, lots of basics, makes sense. Ghost Quarter, lots of basics, it's Budget Strip Mine, yeah. There New Benalia, so this is the Scry one, right?
Yes.
Okay, so this is the Future Sight card that gave us the Scry cycle from Theros Block.
Nice card.
Yeah, and then Basilica, of course, makes perfect sense, I love it. Love it, love it. Guild Gate. Alright, so we're just getting to the duels here.
Yeah, this is not crazy about Guild Gate. All
right. Rogue's Passage. Okay, so to me anyway, what matters most is not making your commander unblockable, but making your 20/20 spirit tokens coming off of it unblockable, which if the game goes on long enough...
Nice. Yeah. Very nice. And all you need is 7 mana, so...
There we go. Easy enough. Scoured Barrens.
Just getting life. Simple enough.
There's
the cycle one.
Yeah.
It's up there where it always is.
Tainted Fury. Okay.
Alright.
Temple
of False God.
Another goes in. Yeah. There we go.
There you go.
And then Evolving Wild. I mean, Terramorphic Expanse. Alright.
Same thing as just more land destruction.
Yep.
Hello?
I don't think
that's not land destruction. Just
No. It's fetching. Yeah. Basic fetching.
So another Evolving Wilds. Alright.
Okay. This is...
Nothing else I gotta
That's it. That's pretty good, I'd say. What do you think, Colin? Pretty you satisfied with your purchase?
Right. I'm pretty satisfied.
Good. All right. Well,
Logan, come here and
that's that's it for now. T1 Glistener Elf signing off. Say goodbye to YouTube land.
Bye, YouTube.
And for the baby.
Say bye-bye. Say bye-bye.
Oh, I'm being shy today. All right. Well, I'll see you later, you two. Take care of yourselves. Bye-bye.